Everyone, and thank you for joining us. My name is Brianne Todd. I'm a professor at the Near East South Asia Center for Strategic Studies at the National Defense University in Washington, D.C., and I will be the moderator for today's webinar as 8 current and former U.S. ambassadors reflect on 30 years of cooperation between the United States and the Republic of Uzbekistan. Before we begin, a few quick reminders for everyone. Today's webinar is being recorded and will be available for viewing after the event. The webinar consists of 3 panel sessions. I will briefly introduce the theme for each session and the ambassador speaking during that respective session. Each ambassador will then provide approximately 5 minutes of opening remarks, followed by an hour of moderated discussion. At any time during the session, you may submit questions for the ambassadors. Please submit your questions using the Q&A function at the bottom of your screen. Between each session, there will be a 15-minute break. Unfortunately, due to Zoom's limited webinar functionality, we will all leave the webinar at the conclusion of each session, but you can enter again at any time using the same link. With that, I would like to welcome Ambassador Javlon Vakhabov, the Ambassador of the Republic of Uzbekistan to the United States. Ambassador Vakhabov joined Uzbekistan's Ministry of Foreign Affairs in 2001, serving early career assignments as an attaché, third secretary, and chief of division. In 2006, he was appointed to Uzbekistan's National Security Council, and in 2011, he was promoted to deputy secretary of the council. In 2013, Ambassador Vakhabov served as the director of the Institute for Strategic and Interregional Studies before joining the leadership team at the Foreign Ministry later that year as one of 4 deputy ministers of foreign affairs. In July 2015, he was promoted to first deputy minister of foreign affairs, the title he held until he was appointed ambassador to the United States in 2017. Ambassador Vakhabov, the microphone is yours.
So good morning and good evening to everyone, depending on where you are. So first of all, I would like to thank all ambassadors for making a time and joining this event despite family and business commitments and ongoing government service. And I need to admit that gathering you all was not an easy task, but I immensely so grateful to Professor Brianne Todd for her hard work in putting all ambassadors together and making today's event happen. So dear ambassadors, so it's a distinct honor and a privilege for me on the eve of 30th anniversary of Uzbekistan's independence to welcome 8 United States senior diplomats who had led American embassy in Uzbekistan, and I witnessed all the tremendous change in the country. So history of nation building, evolving democracy, progress and transformation of my country over the past 3 decades. So they had left the legacies that became the foundation for ever strengthening and deepening strategic partnership between Uzbekistan and the United States. So they followed Uzbekistan through its 30 years of journey, supporting and encouraging so the young nation, contributing to its success and maintaining strong bilateral relations despite ups and downs. So 30 years ago, so the people of Uzbekistan achieved long desired independence and freedom, look their destiny into their own hands, conscious of the challenges ahead, but determined to overcome them and to succeed. And it is gratifying to note that the United States was among the first recognized Uzbekistan's independence. And it happened on December 25th, 1991, when I was just 11 years old, when President George Bush announced so the decision in his address to the nation regarding the dissolution of the Soviet Union. And on February 19th, just a year passed, 1992, Uzbekistan and the United States established diplomatic ties. So since then, Uzbekistan evolved from a Soviet republic with a command and control model into a market-oriented economy, propelled by a wide range of reforms and to a self-sustaining sovereign country that strives for its development. Uzbekistan has entered a completely new phase of its development in 2016, exactly almost 5 years ago, after election of President Shavkat Mirziyoyev. In a relatively short period of time, our country gained remarkable achievements. Uzbekistan entered the top five fastest growing economies in the world and continuing to extend its far-reaching social reforms, which are designed to further improve the well-being of our people. So we liberalized our economy, including through ensuring free floating of the national currency that you know well, ambassadors, hindered investment flow over the years. So we made meaningful steps to ensure good governance, so the rule of law and human rights. And I need to stress here that long criticized issues related to the forced labor, trafficking in person, and the suppression of religious freedom are no longer the case in Uzbekistan. So with a good neighborhood, well-balanced, open and constructive foreign policy, we've reached the level of friendship and trust in the region as never before, and strengthen the ties with our partners across the world. Indeed, none of these successes were achievable without sovereignty, territorial integrity, and independence. And we greatly appreciate the United States' enduring commitment to these key foundations of our nation. During the first years of independence, when the first president of and founder of Uzbekistan, Islam Karimov, dedicated his entire life above all to preserving and strengthening the sovereignty, seeking international recognition of Uzbekistan's regional and global significance, so the U.S. Secretary of State James Edison Baker visited Tashkent and Samarkand in 1992 to support a young nation's aspirations. It followed by establishment of the American embassy in Tashkent in March with Chargé Michael Mazur, led to succeeded by the first U.S. ambassador to Uzbekistan, His Excellency Henry Clarke, who actually launched the operation of the U.S. mission in Tashkent. And thank you, Ambassador, for being with us today. So during the first visit to the United States in 1996, Uzbekistan president inaugurated new embassy in DC, so the building where I'm currently staying in front of you, so giving impetus to further deepening multifaceted bilateral relations. So cooperation between the countries, especially in the security dimension, enhanced to a new level after 9/11 terrorist attacks when Uzbekistan availed itself to provide logistical support for the US-led counterterrorism campaign in neighboring Afghanistan. So an establishing strategic partnership in 2002 became a significant milestone in the history of our bilateral relations, strengthening cooperation in the political, economic, military, humanitarian, and other areas. So since 2016, the cooperation has grown substantially across all areas of our bilaterals and regional collaboration. And our relationship has entered into a new era of strategic partnership that was launched during the historic visit of President Mirziyoyev to the United States in May 2018, reinvigorating bilateral trade relations with multi-billion contracts, strengthening cooperation in higher education and academic research, agriculture and energy, and meal-to-meal partnership. And our strategic partnership continues to gather momentum, this momentum, and it's not an overstatement to say our relations have never before enjoyed such depth and breadth. So elevation of annual political consultations first launched in 2009 to the level of strategic partnership dialogue was an inaugural dialogue planned to take place in Tashkent this December creates new opportunities to advance even closer and stronger cooperation across political, security, economic, and human dimensions. And our collaboration within the C5 plus one, so a regional diplomatic platform, successfully launched in November 2015 during the then Secretary of State John Kerry's visit to Samarkand, has also significantly increased. C5 plus one high-level meetings convened in Tashkent last year during Secretary Pompeo's visit, and this month within the International Conference, Central and South Asia, Regional Connectivity, Challenges and Opportunities, attended by Dr. Elizabeth Sherwood Randall, so the President Homeland Security Advisor, paves so the way for absolutely new positive dynamics in the U.S. engagement in the region by seizing opportunities to strengthen connectivity between Central and South Asia via trade, so transport and energy links, as well as advancing peace and reconciliation in Afghanistan. So over these years, so we have accomplished a lot together, and I'm confident that with building upon past achievements, relationship between our countries will even more strengthened and enhanced in many more years to come. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Ambassador Vakhabov, for your keynote remarks. At this time, we have a short montage to share with you, documenting the last 30 years of partnership between the United States and Uzbekistan.
This is CNN Breaking News.
Good evening, I'm Gene Randall in Washington. We are standing by for an Oval Office address by President Bush, as he contributes to a day even historians may have trouble describing. A day when Mikhail Gorbachev resigned as the president of a Soviet Union which had already ceased to exist. The new power broker, Russian President Boris Yeltsin. In a statement issued a short time ago, President Bush praised Gorbachev for what he called his years of sustained commitment to world peace. He also spoke of his intellect, vision, and courage. The two men spoke by phone before Gorbachev delivered his televised resignation speech. Mr. Bush will look ahead to a future of dealing with the new Commonwealth of Independent States, and we are told now the president will go ahead with formal recognition of those republics, notably Russia. We'll be back after the president's address, which we understand will be fairly brief.
The United States also recognizes today, as independent states, the remaining six former Soviet republics: Moldova, Turkmenistan, Azerbaijan, Tajikistan, Georgia, and Uzbekistan.
lama, ha ha, coca lama.
Since Uzbekistan established its independence from the Soviet Union in 1991, Uzbekistan has been a key partner in supporting U.S. interests in ensuring stability, prosperity, and security in the broader Central Asian region. To quote former Secretary of State Warren Christopher, our approach is to cooperate where our interests coincide and to manage our differences constructively and candidly where they do not. For our first panel today on U.S. relations with Uzbekistan post-independence, we are joined by the men who served as the first three U.S. ambassadors to Uzbekistan. All had distinguished careers before arriving in Tashkent, and they brought with them the experience and resilience necessary to establish relations and focus Washington's attention on a part of the world that had previously been overlooked. Our first speaker is Ambassador Henry Clarke. After graduating from Dartmouth and Harvard and serving in the U.S. Army, Ambassador Clarke began his career in the Foreign Service. His postings included Munich, Lagos, Washington, two tours in Bucharest, including as Deputy Chief of Mission, an economic counselor in Moscow and Tel Aviv, before he became the first U.S. ambassador to Uzbekistan in 1992. He then served as International Affairs Advisor to the National War College at the National Defense University and worked on restitution of property seized by Nazis and communists in Eastern Europe. After retiring from the Foreign Service, Ambassador Clarke served as supervisor of Brčko District and Deputy High Representative for Bosnia and Herzegovina, and later undertook a short assignment as the Director of the Office of Provincial Affairs at the U.S. Embassy in Baghdad. Ambassador Clarke is the author of the forthcoming book, A New Embassy Along an Ancient Route in Uzbekistan. Also joining us today is Ambassador Stanley Escudero. In 1967, he launched his career as a diplomat in Pakistan and Niger. He was appointed staff aide to the ambassador and political officer at the U.S. Embassy in Iran, where he later returned in an undercover operation during the Iranian Revolution. He served as the counselor of political affairs to the U.S. embassies in Egypt and India before being nominated by President George H.W. Bush to be the first U.S. ambassador to Tajikistan. Ambassador Escudero then served as the U.S. ambassador to Uzbekistan from 1995 to 1997 and the U.S. ambassador to Azerbaijan from 1997 to 2000. After retiring from the Foreign Service, Ambassador Escudero founded Shieldbearer LLC, a consulting firm based in Florida and Azerbaijan. Rounding out this panel is Ambassador Joseph Presel. Ambassador Presel joined the Foreign Service in 1963 and specialized in Russian, multilateral diplomacy, and political military affairs. His postings included Turkey, France, Moscow, Belgrade as Deputy Chief of Mission, and twice in the U.S. Arms Control Delegation in Vienna, the second time as Deputy U.S. Representative. Ambassador Presel also served as the coordinator for regional affairs in the new independent states and became special negotiator for Nagorno-Karabakh in 1995. In November 1997, President Bill Clinton appointed Ambassador Presel to be ambassador to the Republic of Uzbekistan. He presented his credentials to President Karimov in December 1997 and served in Tashkent until October 2000. We'll begin with each ambassador providing opening remarks to set the stage for our discussion. As the moderator, I'll ask them some follow-up questions and we'll also take questions from the audience. Again, you may submit your questions at any time during the session. And with that, I'll turn the microphone over to Ambassador Clarke for his opening remarks. Okay, we're going to go ahead and go to Ambassador Escudero and we'll come back to Ambassador Clarke.
Well, I came to Uzbekistan as ambassador in 1995 from Tajikistan, where I had been the first U.S. ambassador, just as Henry was the first in Tashkent. And what I saw, based on my experience in Tajikistan, which had just gone through a brutish civil war, was that Uzbekistan, like so many of the newly independent states, required stability above all. This is in part because when the constituent republics of the Soviet Union were created, when Joseph Stalin was Commissar for Nationalities, he purposely created future divisiveness, setting up different ethnic groups within the same SSR territory, and otherwise making it more difficult for any particular ethnic group to unite against the Russian center, which made a certain amount of sense from the point of view of Soviet colonialism, but created serious problems for these countries when they became independent. You also had conflicts between nations, as in the case of, say, Armenia and Azerbaijan. And Uzbekistan, while it is primarily Uzbek, does have a substantial Tajik minority, and they also control, as part of their territory, a substantial part of the Fergana Valley, which had been the heartland of radical Islam in that part of the region ever since the Basmachi Wars in the early 1920s. So the most important thing that President Karimov could do, it seemed to me, was to guarantee the stability and therefore the time which the nation and people of Uzbekistan needed to adjust to the new realities. The transition from the Soviet Union to an independent state was intensely traumatic for the people in Central Asia. They had undergone about 74 years of Soviet domination. And in the case of Uzbekistan, Tashkent had been the administrative center of the Tsarist Empire in that part of the world. So Uzbekistan had not been an independent state for well over a century. And there was no preparation for independence. It was thrust upon them overnight without really any warning at all. Suddenly they were told that everything they had ever known or believed to be true about the evolution of states, about the perfectibility of humankind, about proper political governance and behavior, about national economics, and all of this suddenly was false. and that those things which they had been told about the West and capitalism were really in fact true. And that what's worse, we Americans, who they had been told would cheerfully drink the blood of their babies given the opportunity, were in fact really their friends. And they should listen to our advice. The whole world had been turned upside down. And this was a time of great trauma and adjustment and attitudinal change for the people of Uzbekistan, indeed for the people of all the newly independent states. And it was quite clear from what resulted in several of those countries that it would be possible to collapse into violence and chaos if stability was not assured. And that was the great thing which Islam Karimov did, in my opinion. It's certainly true that there were human rights issues. It is also true that, in my opinion at least, he made a serious error with respect to closing off his economy and establishing a multi-tiered currency system. But he did these things on the basis of the understanding that he had acquired as communist ruler of Uzbekistan, and he would believe that he was doing these things for the good of his country because he had substantial gold reserves at the time, and he feared that those would all be spent on what he called Chinese chewing gum, on meaningless commercial products. But the truth is that while Uzbekistan was and had been, I guess, for quite some time, a cotton monoculture, Uzbekistan also had a number of other things it could draw upon. In addition to gold and silver reserves, Uzbekistan had the second largest solar furnace in the world, which achieved temperatures approaching 6,000 degrees Kelvin. They had an airline industry which could actually work in titanium, which was rare in those days, even for the West. In short, Uzbekistan, even though it was the world's largest double landlocked country, had an extraordinary future that it could look toward once it made the transition, which was going to be necessary to come to terms with its new independence and to adapt to the rules of international commerce and international political activity. This was going to take a while. At the same time, Uzbekistan also had to deal with the fact that the trade routes, the pipelines, the electrical grid, all of this still focused north toward what had been the Soviet center and was now Russia. And that provided them with certain ties to the former center, which to some degree were necessary, but to some extent also limited their capacity to make the kinds of changes that were necessary. This was a difficult time because not only were the people making these mental internal adjustments, but there was some considerable trauma which the country faced as a result of the impact of certain of President Karimov's economic decisions and some of the controls which he felt were necessary and which in fact may have been at that time. But the Uzbeks as a people are strong, they're disciplined, they're hardworking, and stability and their own internal strengths won out. The proof is that when President Karimov passed, there was no violence, there was no struggle for power, there was a relatively smooth, easy transition, and you have President Mirziyoyev in power now, and he saw that the time had come with President Karimov's passing and his ascension to the presidency to then make the kinds of changes which were necessary to bring Uzbekistan politically and economically fully into the modern world, into the international world, the global world, if you will. He did this, and he has done it, and he is doing it, and he continues to do it smoothly in ways which sustain Uzbekistan's partnership with the West and provides new opportunities for Western investment. This is exactly the best, I think, that Uzbekistan could have hoped for. And so now the country is moving into a brighter future. But of course, it does face new regional challenges, as all the nations in Central Asia do. Some of this is the result of American withdrawal from Afghanistan, which changes the equation. Some of it also is a result of continuing Russian desire to reestablish its influence in the region, both economically and politically. And then you have a new actor on the scene. You have China, which is an aspiring global hegemon, which via its Belt and Road Initiative and several regional political economic structures, which it has set up, is vying also in the global competition, which used to be called the Great Game, to establish itself as an influential player in the area. And Uzbekistan is going to have to deal with this. Fortunately, from, I think, Uzbekistan's perspective, and certainly from that of the United States, given the important role that Uzbekistan will play in Central Asia in the future, all of that will be done, I certainly hope, in close partnership with the United States, as we have been and remain strategic partners. End of my remarks.
Ambassador Presel, we'll go to you for your remarks. We can hear you.
I'm not much better than Henry Clarke. First of all, I'd like to thank you for organizing this thing. Secondly, I'd like to say that Stan Escudero is a hell of a tough act to follow, both in a conference like this and as ambassador. And I'd like to say that one of the reasons that my assignment there was successful, if it was thanks to three people, two of whom are here today. One is Henry Clarke, and the other is Stan Escudero. That made it a lot easier. The third, of course, is Foreign Minister Kamilov, a remarkable man who cares desperately about making Uzbekistan part of the world community and part of the Western community. I owed all three of these gentlemen a great deal. Now, by the time I got there, we and the Uzbeks had gotten used to each other. We were still proceeding occasionally on slightly different lines. And what I like to say is that we and they, by the late 90s, we were sort of like adolescents discovering sex. This is not very polite, but I think it works. That is to say, we liked it, we wanted more of it, but we weren't quite sure how to go about getting it. That operates for both the Uzbeks and the Americans. So we had remarkable success in developing some of our relationships. The intelligence relationship was quite remarkable. Those of you who have read Steve Cole's book about bin Laden in Afghanistan will realize the extent to which the Uzbeks helped us an awful lot while I was there, and then even more after I'd left. The commercial relationship was mostly equally good. Yes, there was the problem of cotton. There was the problem of the largest American investment in Uzbekistan, which was Newmont Mining, having its company taken over under conditions that were at the very least questionable. And that's too bad. But by and large, these relationships existed. And to the extent that they weren't entirely successful, it was, I think, because a lot of us, most of us, didn't quite understand what the other guy was getting at. That made it somewhat more difficult. Politically, our relations were fine, except that is where human rights were involved. And even there was a change. While I was there, I had the somewhat peculiar fortune of being present when there was an attempt made to assassinate President Karimov. And they came a lot closer than they'd like to say they did. And after that, the relationship deepened quite a lot, as Karimov, I think, realized that he was going to need us in a way that he hadn't perhaps thought of before. So that was a desirable thing. The Uzbeks also discovered, as Stan was saying, that it's not quite right to talk about the five Central Asian countries, the Stans. There are two major Central Asian countries, Uzbekistan and Kazakhstan, and the other three. You play the hand you're dealt. But Uzbekistan clearly was the most important of the five countries, despite Kazakhstan having all the oil in the world. And it had a sense of who, the Uzbeks had a sense of whom they were. They knew that they were a settled, urban, intellectual society with a great history, and that it was normal for them to take the lead. Beyond that, they had a fairly highly developed economy. Dan Escudero talked about the ability to work with titanium in the aircraft industry. They made airplanes. They made airplanes which people fly. And the Uzbek Airlines, which use, I'm happy to tell you, mostly Boeing jets, was one of the first really Western operated kind of an airline. It was not perhaps quite Swiss Air, but it came close. So our relationship improved a lot, despite the downsides. And had we and the Uzbeks understood each other better, we might not have gone quite to the extent to which we did when they needed help as we invaded Afghanistan, but also how far down it went when we and they disagreed on what should happen next. By and large, our relations are pretty good. They're pretty good now. Yes, there are problems. Yes, we talk about them. And while there's still a difference of presentation, I think that all of my successors are very pleased at what they did. And I think all of us, my predecessors and my successors, agree that we all had a great deal of fun being the ambassador to Uzbekistan. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Ambassador Presel. And we'll go now to Ambassador Clarke.
I arrived in Tashkent as ambassador in September of 1992. And my most important message for the government of Uzbekistan was that the United States supports Uzbekistan's independence. That was no surprise. They were aware that even though we did not cause the breakup of the Soviet Union, we certainly believed the republics were entitled to their independence. But what did we mean by supporting independence? Well, what I thought we meant was that we would expand our relationships between our two countries first, in any way that was beneficial to both sides. And second, it meant membership in a host of international organizations, most of which the United States already belonged to, and where we could, with other countries, assist Uzbekistan in becoming a part of the international community. But independence didn't come just in one stroke. It continued to expand during the time I was in Tashkent. First of all, economic independence. The ruble zone fell apart, and with its own currency, Uzbekistan received a large dose of economic independence. In 1993, there were SOM coupons, and then in 1994, the SOM itself was introduced. In November of 94, the special representative for the newly independent states, James Collins, called on President Karimov, and his most important message that I heard was that the United States does not recognize a zone of influence for Russia in Uzbekistan or any other country. Uzbekistan took control of its border guards, and in a meeting with Stan Escudero and me in December of 1994, President Karimov told us that Uzbekistan, as I think the first country in Central Asia, had taken charge of its border guards. Soon thereafter, in April of 1995, Secretary of Defense of the United States, Bill Perry, came to Tashkent And one of his interesting messages was that he felt that Uzbekistan was one of the three countries breaking off from Russia that has a good had a good chance for a permanent independence, the other two being Kazakhstan and Ukraine. And our relate with this connection between Uzbekistan and our Defense Department, Uzbekistan joined the Partnership for Peace and actually sent a unit to Louisiana for exercises before I left Tashkent in September of 95. If you are at all interested in this period of time between the United States and Uzbekistan, I hope you will have a chance to read my book, which is due to be published in a few months, hopefully before the end of the year. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Ambassador Clarke. And we now will have our moderated discussion. As a reminder to all of the attendees, if you have questions for any of the ambassadors, please use the Q&A function at the bottom of your screen and submit those at any time. In the meantime, I have lots of questions for the ambassadors. And I'm going to start with you, Ambassador Clarke, as the first ambassador. So you arrive in September of 1992. And as you and I have discussed, you land at the airport and less than 2 days later, you're meeting with President Karimov. Uzbekistan is still a pretty new country at this point, and the embassy is also still pretty new. There's a lot of work to be done. What are your impressions during this period? I mean, where do you even begin to roll up your shirt sleeves and dig in?
Well, I didn't have the luxury of sitting around waiting for my credentials to be accepted, as happens in so many capitals. I was seen by all the necessary people, one right after another, had to start work right away. I don't know if that answers your question, but we already had a building. It's not a building that everybody came to like, but at the time, it was the only embassy building in Central Asia, and it served our purposes. But that's the material side of creating an embassy. Obviously, the more important part was developing relations. And we signed a lot of agreements in those first 3 years.
So as the ambassador, though, what was your priority going in? I mean, was it establishing political relations, economic relations? You mentioned Secretary Perry's visit and military cooperation. What were you really focused on during this period?
To say that I was focused on one primary thing would be, I think, a mistake. I realized we had to try everything. We didn't know what would work. We didn't know what areas would turn out to be the most fruitful in our bilateral relations. So we tried to do all we could. And we expanded exchanges enormously. We began humanitarian assistance, especially near the Aral Sea, where there were serious illnesses arising from the salt of the dried up Aral Sea. We had plenty to do.
Ambassador Escudero, I'm going to go next to you. So we had many of our first ambassadors to the newly independent states with backgrounds in Russia, had worked in Eastern Europe. You were kind of the exception among the group. Your background had been in Iran. You were a Farsi speaker, you get sent to Tajikistan, but then from there you go to Uzbekistan. How did that experience shape your perspective on Uzbekistan and maybe have you approach it in a way slightly different from some of your colleagues? You're muted, sir.
Now can you hear me? All right. Yes, I came to Uzbekistan with a slightly different background. In fact, I will say that I came to Uzbekistan not to tell war stories, but as Ambassador Clarke pointed out, I had had the privilege of meeting with President Karimov and with Henry Clarke in while I was still ambassador to Tajikistan, and I came to know Uzbekistan fairly well because Uzbekistan also intervened to some degree to help bring an end to the Tajik civil war through the use of a brigade of Uzbek Spetsnaz headed by my old friend Sasha Chubarov, and as a result, I had learned a bit more about Uzbekistan than might ordinarily have been the case. But I also came from Iran, from an Iranian background. The Iranians, of course, when they seized the embassy, got hold of the reports that I had sent in from my time there, and they came to regard me as a CIA agent and many things that I was not. And so they told Ambassador or President Karimov that as ambassador, I would be a dangerous fellow and that I should not be. I should not be accepted as ambassador to Uzbekistan, and President Karimov, having met me and having heard from President Rahmon of Tajikistan what I had done there, very politely told the Iranians to do something anatomically impossible and with themselves and the camel they rode in on, and accepted me, I think, very graciously as ambassador. But yes, my feeling was that moving to Uzbekistan from Tajikistan was moving to a nation which had the capacity to be many things that sadly Tajikistan wasn't yet ready to become. And that there were extraordinary opportunities and possibilities in Tajikistan. As Ambassador Presel pointed out, initially in those years, even though they had no oil, Uzbekistan was the most important of the five Central Asian states, because it had the most ethnically unified population. It had more in the way of industrial capacity. It had the stability that I spoke of. It had a powerful armed force. Uzbeks are and have proven themselves to be historically potentially a warlike people. And this was not such a bad thing in those days. Long and the short of it was, Uzbekistan had opportunities to move ahead rapidly as long as it could sustain itself against the pressures and traumas that I mentioned earlier. And so I came with the hope that I would be able to build on the strong foundation that Ambassador Clarke had made. We had excellent AID programs. We were working in a number of areas to help Uzbekistan in a physical sense, to help them with the development of their country. Newmont Mining was there at the time, and they were mining vast amounts of gold. And there were other sites, several in Uzbekistan, which were producing both gold and silver. In fact, there was one site over in the eastern part of the country where there were mines that had actual breccia pipes in the side. You see in the movies these gold veins, you see them running. We never really see that. But in this case, you actually did. The thing about it was, of course, that it wasn't pure gold, it was alloyed with silver. Uzbekistan had extraordinary opportunities like that. And initially, at least, President Karimov was very much in favor of opening up Uzbekistan's economy to a variety of different Western influences. This changed a bit when he became concerned about the depletion of the country's gold reserves and the tendency of the people to engage in personal commerce, as I said, bringing in things which he didn't feel were necessary to the economy, and he made some decisions which created issues. And Uzbekistan also had a number of problems held over from Soviet days. They had over-dependence on cotton, which is, of course, subject to the vagaries of weather and that sort of thing. And they have a very serious problem, and to some degree, although to a lesser degree now, still do, in the western part of the country. The Soviets had used the waters of the Amudarya and Sirdarya rivers for agricultural purposes. And they had also created industries using those waters and polluted them in the process, so that a great deal of polluted water first flowed into the Aral Sea and then stopped flowing in there altogether. And as the Aral Sea dried up, it left a thick rime of polluted salt on the surface. There is an annual wind that blows from the north across the Aral Sea basin and into the rest of the country, and that began to blow this white polluted salt up into the air in a condition that was known regionally among the Karakalpak who lived out there as the white wind. It kills crops, it kills livestock, and it sickens and kills people to the extent that Karakalpaks in the Uzbek army were more likely to be sick than Uzbeks from the rest of the country. So it's a serious regional problem that had to be dealt with. And we were eager to help the Uzbeks with this, but it was a problem which other countries in the region didn't have to that extent. There were potential other problems left over from Soviet days. The Soviets had some biological warfare plants on the islands out in the Aral Sea. And as the sea dried up, those islands, they weren't islands anymore, permanently connected to the land. The Soviets didn't clean those places up before they left. We sent a team out there in hazmat suits to have a look at the place, and it scared the hell out of them. But the problem was rodents and other creatures out there run the risk of acquiring some of the diseases that the Soviets were working on and then moving them into the mainland. Fortunately, that hasn't happened to any substantial degree. But that kind of cleanup also remains a problem and remained a problem for the Uzbeks. We were able, fortunately, to help them with that. They were also concerned about the well-being of their ethnic brethren, the Jozjani Uzbeks, who live just across the river in a section of northwestern Afghanistan, because of the constant struggle which had been going on there for years and which continues to. And so they had to develop, they already had relationships, of course, ethnic personal relationships, commercial relationships with their brethren on the other side of the river, but they had a significant foreign policy issue and how exactly they should relate to them without involving themselves in the unending bloody struggles which continue to characterize Afghanistan today. And they handled this beautifully. Finally, there was just the question of how to establish, building again on what Henry had accomplished. And I must say he did a splendid job as the first ambassador out there, since we were all feeling our ways. But how to establish and build on a relationship between the United States and Uzbekistan, two historically very different countries with no real tradition of interaction at all. How to develop a relationship which could be mutually beneficial, which could support and sustain each other's interests in the region, but which would help Uzbekistan grow into the stable, powerful regional linchpin, which it could become and has been becoming. That was my concern as ambassador.
Ambassador Presel, I'm going to bring you into this conversation. So by the time you arrive, you've had two ambassadors there before you. Relations are pretty well established, but at this point, there does start to be some concerns about the security situation in the region. As Ambassador Escudero mentioned, Afghanistan, there are some terrorist organizations operating in Uzbekistan at this period. What are your priorities? What are the Uzbek government's priorities during the time that you're in Tashkent? I need you to unmute, sir.
I apologize, but I don't quite understand why he keeps muting, but never mind. I think what the Uzbeks wanted by the time I got there was to be considered as a serious, mature country, part of the world community, not one of the stands. They wanted us to consider them, as it were, like, well, I don't know, Malaysia, Netherlands, something like that. They knew that they weren't wealthy in the way that those two countries were. They knew that we had problems with them in some areas, as they with us. They also knew that the Americans had to be fair with respect to the other four countries, even though they didn't quite understand why that was necessary, but they sort of did, and that presented problems. The security relationship was actually rather good. I don't want to be telling tales out of school, but one of the more bizarre but pleasant experiences was awarding graduation diplomas to a class of Uzbek special forces people. I was one of the two awarders, and the other was the head of the Uzbek security services. And both I and I think the general found it somewhat piquant that 5-6 years after independence, our relationship was such. And as I said in my opening remarks, the relationship with the Uzbek services and the Uzbek government in general, and my relationship with Karimov, and I would hazard the relationship of my successors, changed quite radically. Because they realized that they became a lot closer to losing their president than they thought. It went sour after a while, but it was quite remarkable when I was there. We, for our side, had to get used to the fact that Uzbekistan is not the same thing as Tajikistan. And it's one thing to say, yeah, well, they speak a form of Turkish, and the other people speak a form of Persian, whether we're 30 million people in there, whatever it is, 4 or 5. But the history of Uzbekistan, the role of Tashkent at the end of the Russian Empire, and to be fair, during most of the Soviet Empire, puts them in a somewhat different position. And working our way through that was, I think, the biggest problem I had. The other was that we had kind of different reasons for going about the more declarative parts of our relationship. For them, visits by senior officials was showing the flag and having pictures in the local papers of important people shaking the hands of important Americans. For us, these visits, not to put too fine a point on it, were to do casework. We had a problem with this, we want to solve it. We had a problem with that, we want to solve it. They have a problem, we want to solve it. So that made it a little bit more difficult. And then too, the American bureaucracy is kind of a juggernaut. And once you start it, it's kind of hard to stop. So when I got there, I discovered that we were spending a fair amount of money establishing a Uzbek stock exchange. I won't comment. But that was not perhaps the best possible use of American money and time and effort. I think we put the relationships, they and us, onto a firmer footing, one of them more nearly mutual respect, we looking down less at them, and they being much less self-conscious as to who they were.
I want to ask each of you your views on how you related to your counterparts from Russia and some of the other countries during your time in Tashkent. Ambassador Escudero mentioned, you know, the fact that Russia was a major player, but now increasingly we see China. Was China really present in the 1990s? Ambassador Clarke wrote an article in 1999 for Central Asian Survey where he kind of dismisses some of the myths about U.S. engagement in Central Asia, including the fact that the U.S. was present to contain Russia. But obviously, there were a lot of suspicions about what our presence meant in Uzbekistan at this point. What were you witnessing and what were you experiencing during your tenures in Tashkent? So Ambassador Clarke, we'll start with you and then go to Ambassador Escudero and Ambassador Presel.
Chinese recognized Uzbekistan fairly early on and established an embassy in Tashkent. But during my assignment to Tashkent, they were one of the quietest of embassies in town. We had a Chinese restaurant somewhere near Samarkand. We had tons of Chinese consumer goods pouring into the country, into all the open markets. But we had very little political presence of the Chinese.
And Russia at that time?
Russia was, of course, an extremely important country, major trading partner, and that continued. They were also extremely important because Russians were one of the important minorities in the country, and so they, in a way, represented a lot of Uzbekistan citizens. However, one of the firm rules established by President Karimov was that there would be no dual citizenship. And that provided, again, another element of independence for Uzbekistan. But there were lots of issues for the Russians to deal with in maintaining relations with Uzbekistan. They were frequent visitors and seemed to accept, however, Uzbekistan's independence. That saved everyone a lot of grief.
Ambassador Escudero, your thoughts on this?
Yes. Well, I think the situation was largely, during my 2 years there, were largely unchanged from that which Ambassador Clarke has just described. The Chinese were quiet, but they were very, very active commercially. And we, that is to say, my embassy and the Chinese embassy had good relations. We entertained one another from time to time, as diplomatic embassies do. And it was quite clear that the Chinese at the time were not actively pursuing political military goals in the way that they are today, but that their primary concern and focus was the development and expansion of their commercial interests and their exports to Uzbekistan. There was some talk, some possibility of pipelines heading east, gas pipelines and that sort of thing, but that never really developed into anything significant while I was there. With respect to Russia, of course, the situation was very different. Russia also at that time was undergoing vast internal changes. And their primary focus at that time was internal, just as was the case with Uzbekistan and the other newly independent states. At the same time, the old commercial ties and lines, as I said in my initial remarks, continued to exist between Uzbekistan and Russia. And there remained among the Russians and to a considerable degree among some Uzbeks, a certain sadness that the Soviet Union had ceased to exist and that the level of intimacy which had existed before was no longer there. Not everyone was able easily to make the transition between life in the Soviet Union, which they had come to understand and accept, and a new and different and in many ways more challenging life as an independent country. And so there was, among some senior respects, a feeling that closer ties with Russia especially on the commercial side, might not be a bad idea. But President Karimov's views at the time were, again, as Ambassador Clarke said, that Uzbekistan was now independent, that it had new opportunities and pathways that it needed to travel, and that while Uzbekistan could never ignore the presence of their super powerful Russian neighbor, and could not and should not try to forget the history of relations between the two of them in Soviet times and Tsarist times before that, that the roles were different now, and one had to adjust to those differences.
Ambassador Presel, would you care to comment?
Sure, thank you. First of all, with respect to the Russians, there was a kind of a relationship that we simply could not begin to match. They went to the same universities. They spoke Russian. The government of Uzbekistan ran in Russian. They had by and large gotten rid of ethnic Russians in the Uzbek army, except that the airplane mechanics and the tank mechanics and the communications needed to be Uzbek, but of ethnic Russian origin. And that made it a little bit more complicated. There was a good deal of respect for the Russians, not very much love, I don't think. Most colonized people don't much like their hegemons, but there was a good deal of respect for them, much or quite rightly. And there were personal relationships that mattered desperately. The Minister of Electricity once said to me that one of the turbines in one of his plants had just gone down and he needed a new one, and how was he going to get it? Well, what he did was he called up the Russian Minister of Electricity, who was in the same institute, his year at the institute, and in fact said, hey, look, can you help? And the guy said, sure. That's the kind of thing that we could never match, nor I think should we try to match. With respect to the Chinese, I don't know. They were very quiet diplomatically. I don't know what they did. The other countries, it was quite interesting. A lot of them, I never understood why they were there. There was a Latvian ambassador. I had no idea what the Latvians did in Uzbekistan until I once asked him. And he said, it's very simple. At the time of the Soviet Union, 1 million tons of Uzbek cotton was exported through Latvian ports. And my job is to see to it that continues. Same thing with the Czech ambassador, very nice man, who explained that his job was to see to it that all the trams in Uzbekistan, which had been made in Czech factories, to continue to be so. Well, I could understand that. We, I think, were the only country that sort of wanted to do everything with the Americans. And they found that, Uzbeks found that somewhat peculiar, because they didn't understand why. And one of the best arguments for exchanges is to make sure that people get to understand one society and the other. The Europeans, by and large, not terribly active, with perhaps the unique exception of the Turks, who because of language and because of history, because of culture, had a leg up, and they were pretty good.
So we have a couple of questions that have come in from the attendees, so I will pose those to our speakers now. We have a question from Dr. Shukrat Baratov from the Australian National University. He recalls that in September of 1995, Uzbekistan hosted the Tashkent Meeting on Security and Cooperation in Central Asia, which was attended by high-level representatives from 31 states and 6 international organizations. And one of the points that was raised during this meeting, Uzbekistan mentioned that there was an absence of a basic mechanism of maintaining security in Central Asia. And one of the ideas that was floated during this period was the establishment of a Central Asian version of the OSCE, with a particular focus on peacemaking in Afghanistan. Ambassador Clarke, Ambassador Escudero, this would have been about the time that You were in Tashkent. Do you recall either this conference or conversations that were being had in Tashkent around this version of a Central Asian version of OSCE?
I remember the conference. I went there, I think, and I spoke under instructions from the department. But to tell you the truth, I do not remember this OSCE idea. And that could have been because I missed that part of the conference, or it could be that I just forgot. We should quickly say that Uzbekistan was already a participant in the OSCE process. So, not obviously clear to me how they would transition to a Central Asian version of the same. But that's about all I can recall from that conference.
Ambassador Escudero, obviously you would not have been at the conference if Ambassador Clarke was, but do you recall conversations about this idea still circulating in Tashkent when you were there?
Yes, they were, but they had diminished somewhat in urgency as it became independent fairly quickly that this was not going to lead to the creation of an influential regional structure which would be able to address specifically the Afghan range of issues. I thought it was significant because it was an instance in which Uzbekistan, as Ambassador Presel pointed out, which was very different from three of the other five Central Asian states, that Uzbekistan was reaching out to establish a degree of regional leadership, and this leadership was being accepted by the other countries in the area. Now, it's certainly true that they didn't achieve what they said they might try to achieve in Afghanistan, but then neither has anyone else. The problem continues to exist. The important thing, I think, was that Uzbekistan was at the time prepared to take on a more important regional role, an international role, and the other nations of the region felt that that was appropriate. I think that that is still a strength that Uzbekistan has, and something which they will find themselves in a position to exercise in the future.
Our next question is from Dr. Vladimir Paramanov, who sends his regards to Ambassador Presel as he recalls meeting him in Tashkent when he was studying US policy on Central Asia in 2000. His question is for all the ambassadors, so if each of you would like to respond to this. What would you identify as the key problem in the way of development of US-Uzbek relations? And obviously this could have changed over the time as you were there at different points, but Ambassador Clarke, we'll start with you.
Well, I wouldn't see any one obstacle, but one thing is always there, and that is the lack of knowledge in the United States where Uzbekistan is and how important it should be in world affairs. I don't have any way of elaborating that. We all know what it means to explain where Uzbekistan is in the United States, because the United States, like many other large countries, tends to look inward more than it does outward.
Thank you, Ambassador Clarke. Ambassador Escudero, your thoughts on this?
Well, I take it that the question is intended to be, what is the major issue? What would have been the major issue at the time that I was ambassador? Not necessarily now, because the two are obviously very different. But at the time when I was ambassador, Henry is, of course, right. Uzbekistan was not, and really could not be, at the forefront of the range of concerns which the United States has, given that our range of concerns is global. That said, because Uzbekistan was considered at that time the central fulcrum of the development of Central Asia, and that it was very important what Uzbekistan did or did not do with regard to its own internal development, I think that the major issue between us, the major problem, if you will, became President Karimov's decision to close off the economy to foreign investment and to create a three-tiered currency exchange system, which frankly made it very difficult for foreign investors who were already there, but also, to be brutally honest about it, facilitated corruption in ways which were not advantageous at all for Uzbekistan over the medium to longer term. And that had to be dispensed with, as has thankfully been done. But that created issues between us, which should not have been there, because it made it much harder for our private sector, which is our primary developmental tool, to assist Uzbekistan in its own development. And it made it harder for the Uzbek people to move into the modern post-Soviet world for them. I mean, after all, it's not a government which develops a country, it's the people that develop the country.
Thank you, Ambassador Escudero. Ambassador Presel.
There are a couple of comments I'd like to make, real short. One is that we're big, and the Uzbeks comparatively are small. There's no getting around that. We can do things that they can't. We want people to do things that we want them to do without necessarily thinking what it does to them. Very American approach to life. The other is that we and they tend to neglect the fact that both countries have politics. It's all very well, my colleagues and I have all used we'd like to do that, but Congress won't let us. And there's a good deal of truth in that, by the way, but it's kind of a crutch on occasion. Because of the unique nature of Uzbek government, particularly under Karimov, the politics tend to be shrouded in mystery, but they exist. And Oblast governors have their bases of power and their own interests and their province's own interests, just as we do. And that makes it very hard on occasion to get things done. It also makes it very hard for each side to understand what the other is trying to do. And it's all very well to say we're right, and why don't they just knuckle under? But other countries don't necessarily see it that way.
In the few minutes that we have remaining in this session, I guess my question to each of you would be, what is the one accomplishment or achievement that the U.S. Embassy and working with their Uzbek partners was able to achieve during the time that you were ambassador that perhaps our audience doesn't know about? This is your opportunity to tell us something that we're not familiar with in the U.S.-Uzbek relationship. I've discovered lots of stories just over the last several months in speaking with each of you. So I know that there are some nuggets out there, but I'll start with you, Ambassador Clarke. What's the one thing you'd like us to know about your time in Tashkent?
We tried to accomplish a lot of different things. And so it's really not easy to pinpoint one as being the key success. But we started a lot of processes. And one of them, I'm sure the other ambassadors are aware of, was the relationship between our defense ministry and Uzbekistan's defense ministry. That was a difficult process, but it was obviously something that President Karimov wanted to participate in and did. And that once he realized that secret police were keeping us away from the Uzbekistan Defense Ministry, he changed that dramatically. And that's what led to a successful visit by the Secretary of Defense and the participation in Partnership for Peace and so forth that all followed. That was perhaps the most dramatic change that I can name. But in so many areas, we started out in those days trying to organize exchanges, visits, investments. We even, for example, assisted in expanding Uzbekistan's oil supplies by financing a major gas injection project at Koktumalak. That was, in my mind at least, obviously something helpful to Uzbekistan's independence, in that it gave Uzbekistan that much more leeway in getting oil supplies. But I think I'll stop there because I could go on with a lot of others. First time this, first time that. That's the honor and privilege of the great master, is you often get to do things for the first time.
Ambassador Escudero.
Well, I think Ambassador Clarke has it right in establishing a brand new relationship with a brand new country. What the United States had to do was address a whole range of issues, basically everything that exists in the relationship between the two countries, and it had to address those things all at once. Henry again did an excellent job in getting this underway. And when I came to Uzbekistan, the relationship was already established on a reasonably solid footing and was developing in the way that I think both of us wanted it to go. The most important thing I think that I could do when I first arrived, given the nature of the Uzbek government and the role which Islam Karimov played at that time, was to establish a mutually cooperative, mutually trustful, and respectful relationship with Karimov himself. And I believe I did this. I think that by the end of my time there, certainly well before that, he had come to respect and understand me as someone who was very much interested in helping facilitate the development of Uzbekistan in ways which responded to Uzbekistan's interests without competing, of course, with our own, but that this was something which would be very much a thing which Uzbekistan ought to want to do, with certain specific exceptions, which I've mentioned a couple of times. And that relationship, that degree of personal trust, given the extent of authoritarian power which Karimov had at the time, was fundamental to the maintenance of and further development of our bilateral relationship. It was also fundamental to a variety of positive changes which took place in Uzbekistan outside of the strict economic issues that, again, that I mentioned before, which I thought were harmful. And in any newly independent, any developing country like this, where there is a single powerful leader, that kind of relationship is fundamental to the achievement of diplomatic goals, really by any country that has relations. Okay?
Ambassador Presel.
First thing I'd like to say is that it's very hard to back cleanup. I was going to talk about exchanges, and Henry Clarke kind of took care of that. I was going to talk about personal relationship with Karimov, and Stan kind of took care of that. I will nevertheless comment very briefly on both. One is that exchanges are good. Exchanges are wonderful. Exchanges in both directions. Exchanges at all levels. Government exchanges, private exchanges, any kind of exchanges. Good. The Peace Corps, whatever good it may be for Peace Corps volunteers themselves, is wonderful for a number of reasons. One of the more important of which is that it's insidious as hell. You get the Peace Corps volunteers out there in the countryside, and they're teaching otherwise the people they're living with wouldn't get to know. So exchanges. And we did pretty well with exchanges. The other is the relationship with Karimov. Not an easy man. I knew him slightly before I got to Tashkent as ambassador. I saw him a lot more often than the official announcements made clear. There was a personal relationship into which I'm not prepared to go here. And it made a difference. Now, the extent to which it's a difference because of me, Joe Presel, or because I was representing the Americans is something I can't possibly comment on, although I suspect that being the American ambassador really was more important than who the American ambassador was. Those are two things I look on as achievements. Thank you very much.
Well, unfortunately, we are out of time for this session, but thank you to all of the attendees, and I extend my sincere thanks to Ambassador Henry Clarke, Ambassador Stanley Escudero, and Ambassador Joseph Presel for their insightful remarks today. We're going to take a break and reconvene at 10 a.m. in Washington, D.C., so in about 13 minutes, for our next session on advancing the strategic partnership between the United States and Uzbekistan. The webinar is going to end at this time, but for those that are attending and want to continue watching, just click on the link that you received and you'll be brought back in for the next session. So thank you very much to everyone.